All right. Welcome to this latest installment of the Rice Report. As you can see, we are in a whole new studio. This is a guest bedroom in my house, which no longer allows for guests. This is dedicated to all of you. The primary purpose of the show is to talk about the three things that people don't want you to talk about: money, politics, and religion. They all make sense. You need to understand them all. They all intertwine. And it's something that's very important for us to ground ourselves and to make sure decisions we make follow things we are in agreement with about those three specific topics. I want to give a special thanks to KCC, the Key Construction Team, for the great work they did in this room. The studio is fantastic, and thank you very much to Scott and his team for all the work that they did in here. Now it's time to get producing shows. So we are moving from a sporadic once every week or 2 weeks or 3 weeks production into nightly. And on occasion, I'm going to have interviews set up in this room or over Zoom to talk with some experts in the field, some critical thinkers, people of great, you know, great resolve, great intellect that'll provide information that I think will offer all of us a different point of view so that we can, again, make good decisions in life. This is the primary function, especially if you're a parent. Making good decisions is very important. Nothing is more important than family. So the better decisions you make, the better and happier family you're going to have. I believe in three basic fundamental approaches to life that you should focus in on: God, family, and country. I think those things are important in that order. And I think it's also important that we seek the truth, that we talk about things that are factually correct, draw some conclusions, of course, as to what may come, what may happen, what may be happening, and then openly and often talk about the things that are difficult to talk about with other people. Because there's a reason that this country and the entire world is in this predicament, because we're going through a Maoist revolution, beginning with political correctness and use of language into elimination of rights, collapse of finances. These things are all happening, whether you want to believe it or not. These are exactly the things that are happening in this country. And if you're not in America, it's happening in your country too. This is a large global war that, even in just today's episode, I'm going to walk you through basic facts that allow you to understand that we are in a covert war that is trying to be hidden by the media powers, who are owned and controlled by the same people who own and control central banks, governments, and media all around the world. So what we do here, pretty simple. I'll try to go through 15 to 20 minutes of some stats, facts, and figures, primarily financial in the beginning, and then we start, that's our money portion, and then we start talking a little bit about political events that are happening, things that are happening along the political lines that we need to pay attention to, regardless of whether you're a Republican, Democrat, Libertarian, Green Party, whatever you are. I am an American. I am formally a Republican. I am a true independent. Not that I believe anything on the left. I don't believe anything on the right either. I think that we're being spoon-fed really bad information by a bird that has two wings. One wing is a Democrat and the other wing is Republican. And as soon as we stop talking about these things and dividing ourselves as Republicans and Democrats, we can actually make some ground and push back on the tyranny that's being imposed on us. And whether you think it's by accident or happenstance, or that the people in Washington are incompetent — they're not incompetent. Guys, they're not incompetent. They're highly competent. They serve a different master. They have a different intention for this country than you do. That's why they use the term "our democracy" and not "democracy." By the way, we are not a democracy. We are a constitutional republic. Very big difference between the two. And we exist in a time of war, a war between Keynesian and Austrian economics. And if you don't know what those two are, I will be doing an episode very soon about the differences between the two, because they're massive. We are in a Keynesian model. An Austrian model is more fair, serves individuals, allows you to thrive, things like that. But we'll go through that at a later date. Right now, there's so much happening out in the world that I don't know that I can cover it all in this amount of time. So I'm going to do my very, very best. And we're going to start digging in right where I usually start, with overall government spending. So right now, we're still spending we're printing $1 trillion every 100 days. There are plenty of good videos online. Look one up. Look and see just how much money $1 trillion is. A billion is 1,000 million. A trillion is 1,000 billion. This is an astronomical amount of money that we are printing every single day, driving ourselves into an absolute rut from an inflationary perspective. More importantly, there are things in money that cost more than money. And inflation is a tax that robs us all. And yesterday, April 15th, was tax day. So I'm sure many of you felt the pain of the government reaching into your pocket and stealing from you. I am going to cover that at the end. I'm going to cover the history of the central bank, where taxes came from, the Titanic, all kinds of things we're going to cover here at the end, because it's a really big story. As you can see behind me, there's a book called The Creature from Jekyll Island. If you haven't read that and you're over the age of 12 years old, you should probably get to reading it and understanding what type of environment you live in. This is why we're seeing such a rush to gold and silver and Bitcoin and some of these other things that are outside of the system somewhat. But there's a reason for it. The reason is that our government is spending money like a drunken sailor, and we all think it's because they're stupid. That's the general narrative. They're dumb, they're incompetent. That's not the case. They are robbing the treasury before the empire burns. The faster you can get that through your head, the better understanding you're going to have of the ground that you stand upon, which will give you a roadmap as to where you need to go. These are very important things. Recent numbers. We know our CPI is around 3.5%. This doesn't include the cost of fuel, and it doesn't include the cost of food. So if you don't have to go anywhere or get anything to eat or go anywhere to get anything to eat, inflation is only 3.5% higher this March than last March. Now, cumulative, looking back from 2021 on, we're at about 21.5% increase, and that's being very, very generous in many areas. But the inflation rate is always dependent upon the Fed funds rate, which we just saw Powell come out and basically give an unchanged stance that there's not enough movement in inflation for them to start lowering rates or raising rates. And this is generally a political thing. I believe that we will see rates lowered at the end of the year, and it's not for any good purposes at all. The reasoning is pretty simple. Where we stand right now, our debt servicing payment is unattainable. So while they're collecting supposed to be collecting $4.71 trillion from individuals and businesses in this country for the luxury of breathing American air, that is what a tax is. Your taxes don't go to roads. Your taxes don't go to schools. That's what your local taxes go to. Federal income tax goes directly to the central bank for the privilege of having their printed money and their poor monetary policy. Only two functions they have. I will dive into that in the end. But I think it's important to understand that where we are right now is extremely dangerous. If we lower rates, the precedent has been set from the 40s and the 70s that in times of hyperinflation or potential hyperinflation, along with high federal interest rates, every time we see a significant drop in those rates, we see hyperinflation. This has happened before. This isn't anything new. Anticipate a rate drop and hyperinflation for this simple fact. Right now, the Fed and the government, which are not one and the same, the Federal Reserve is neither federal and does not have a reserve. It is a private bank that prints money and is supposed to manage monetary policy. But this Federal Reserve and the government have a problem because the government, who collects money from us for the privilege of breathing air, they owe the private Western Central Bank quite a bit of money, $35 trillion almost at the moment. Now, our debt servicing agreement, which is the amount of, it's kind of like when you have a credit card or an interest-only mortgage, you're paying interest. You're just paying the VIG, the interest rate, the profit, the usury that was lent to you. Right now, we're in a position, and this is really something to catch on to, where if they decide to lower rates by 1.5%, 150 basis points. If they decided on a 150 basis point drop, which would still put us in an area of, you know, call it 6%, 6.5% mortgages. If they were to do that, the government could save 33% on the debt servicing payment. Now, I know that this means nothing to most people because it's not our debt, although they collect from us to pay for it. This is a significant thing during a political season. Very significant. As the economy gets worse and worse, which it absolutely is, and we'll go through that. As the economy gets worse, they're going to try to find a political play. They're going to try to find a way to use politics to influence money. And when they do that, the Democrat in office, whoever that guy is, Joe Biden, whatever, whoever that character is, he is going to make a ploy saying the economy's bad. We've got to lower interest rates because it'll save us 33% on our debt servicing payment on the government debt to the private Western Central Bank. Now, if that happens, you can absolutely expect within a month or two hyperinflation to kick in and many other problems. But this day is coming, in my opinion. I think it's a foregone conclusion. It's a great political play for them to use because you have to understand your government doesn't honestly care about your money, your family, your finances. They don't care. They're in it for power. There's a reason that 90% of all congressmen and senators are worth $10 million or more, making $170,000 a year. Now, I digress. We did have a positive number come out that actually makes sense. So if you've been following my episodes, you'll know that I don't buy into anything given to us from the energy sector to the job sector. But we did have a number that came out that actually makes sense that may be legitimate, that retail sales were up 0.7% this past month. That does make sense to me. And it makes sense to me for the simple fact that Americans are in a self-destructive mode. We are in a falling economy, in a falling nation, to be quite frank with you. And I just took my kids to the mall this Saturday and learned many, many different things. First thing I learned is that the mall was packed and people were buying things in the midst of really high inflation, no job growth, no wage growth. And yet people are still buying. How? Well, I can tell you how. We are now at $1.3 trillion in credit card debt. That's at an average of 28% interest. $1.3 trillion of household credit card debt is at 28%. That's $364 billion that Americans will have to pay without lowering their debt at all. That's just the interest. So it does make sense to me that retail sales are up. People are accumulating goods and services and things that they need, knowing that the economy isn't doing great. But it does, everything is a double-edged sword. So yes, it's great. Retail sales are up, but consumer credit debt is $1.3 trillion with 28% interest. This is an unsustainable path. You know, one of the things that's always interesting to me about tax day, aside from the fact that it's many different coincidence and correlations, the Titanic sank on April 15th, Da Vinci was born on April 15th, all these other things are pretty interesting. But the most interesting thing about tax day is the fact that no one seems to realize that in America, per our Constitution, we don't work for the government. They work for us. But on tax day, everyone just bends a knee and gives them whatever they want because we have the threat of going to jail, which I understand. We are in the middle of a large-scale movement in this country that's defying taxation, just like we did in 1776. I want to reiterate, 1776, we killed 600,000 Englishmen because they were taxing us 3%. We now pay, on average, around 40% income tax. And that's just on our income. It doesn't count when we go buy something, the sales tax, when we own a home, the property tax, all the other taxes. But we pay that much, and no one seems to care or bat an eye. This is already socialism, approaching communism. It's time to wake up, America. This time is very important, crucial in human history. But I find it funny that if you forget to put something on your taxes, that they will, within a matter of 60 to 90 days, the IRS will reach out and ask you for proof of, you know, I've had Schedule C taxes removed with no reason. I get bills from, you know, when I lived in California, the state of California, just a bill, you owe me $5,000 more, you owe me $4,000 more. No explanation. They don't have to give an explanation. You just owe it and you just need to prove it. But in the last few years, we've seen, you know, the United States lose $6.2 billion in Ukrainian funding. They don't know where that went. They don't know where $24 billion went in California to solve a homeless problem. That's up 114%. The Pentagon lost $2.3 trillion. I'm going to give credit to this. This is from a parody account of Mr. Powell online on Twitter. And the Treasury just cannot seem to get their hands around $5 trillion they lost during the pandemic. Add those up. You're looking at about $8 trillion that our government and various agencies just lost. They said, you know, I don't have anything to report for it. Please move along. Keep that in mind. It's very important. Now, jobs are also important. We have credit card debt going through the roof. We've got inflation. It's important to note that wages are stagnant. They're not moving up. And that right now, to date, as we sit here on April 16th, 2024, about 71,000 full-time salary jobs have already been lost this month. That's just this month. 71,000 full-time salary jobs have been gone. These are companies like Google, IBM, Bank of America. These are not small companies going out of business. These are large companies laying people off, using AI and robotics to replace them in many instances. But layoffs and shutdowns are occurring. The 99-cent store is about to close down. And I actually applaud them closing it down instead of changing their name to the $1.99 store and moving forward. There is nice to see backbone and branding. Now, the job openings right now are down 2% week over week. So every week, new job openings are down 2%. That's only 16% higher than pre-pandemic levels, pre-shutdown levels. At this pace, in 6 to 9 months, we are going to see the exact same pre-lockdown job openings, which means that the economy has not grown basically since early 2020. These are really important things to note. Now, in the markets, the markets right now, guys, are a sham in certain instances, a complete, you know, mind melt in certain areas, and very clear in certain other areas. So I always try to look for the noise, the signal, and the sign. They're very important. There's signs and there are signals. Some of the signals that we're seeing out there are Bank of Japan. The yen is currently crashing like it hasn't since 1990. Most people are not paying attention to the fact that Japan serves a purpose in the global economy. They are a major, major exporter of currency. They have a lot of extra capital there. Their government structure for bonds has been paying negative, then zero, then 0.25%. So they always seek a higher yield with bigger countries like the United States. The Japanese are a major holder of our treasuries. and they're right now in the middle of a currency collapse, which means ultimately they're going to have to sell off U.S. treasuries to cover the expenses for them to re-strengthen and re-bolster the yen. This time is coming. It's just a matter of when. It's not a matter of if, it's now a matter of when. And this doesn't bode well for the United States because right now our treasury auctions are really bad. We have a treasury auction environment right now where we're not selling the full amount. And even if we do, we have to raise rates to make it more attractive. Right now, it's been declared by a few economists that are good. There are plenty of economists you should never listen to. Again, they repeat exactly what the government tells them. You say this is great. It feels good. It reminds me of biblical times when the false prophets said what you wanted to hear and they were rich and famous. And the true prophets said what you needed to hear and they were killed for it. And right now, some of these good economists out there are letting us know that there is basically a multi-decade bull run that's now over in the treasury world. We are nearing 5% blended on our treasuries. This is really high, unsustainable for the amount of debt that we have. And more importantly, it's affecting things that affect us, right? Treasuries don't necessarily affect individuals in this country. They affect the government, and you know, you might own them in your portfolio. But things that do affect us are mortgage rates. Right now, the 30-year fixed mortgage rate is at 7.43%. This is the highest it's been since December of 2023 when Powell came out and said no rate changes. Then he said there would be rate drops, and then he said there won't be rate drops. So if you keep listening to these things and making these bets, understand that it's all political and almost everything in this world is a psychological operation for you to be able to see through. Nothing more prevalent than finance and crypto at the moment. Those are where the real psyops are. And there's a reason for that, which I'll go into later this week. Now, Bank of America came out and said something that I've been saying for about a year and a half now, is that we are going to see a massive supply crisis in metals. Yes, gold and silver are fairly abundant and easy to get, but copper is the most used metal in the world for electronics. And Bank of America came out today and declared that we are in a supply crisis for copper. So if you are investing in electric vehicles or electronics, understand that things are going to get a lot more expensive. And not all of that expense will be passed off to the consumers because they don't have enough money to use credit cards to buy your products anymore. This is a big vicious cycle that we're going through. Bank of America also came out today with their earnings. They were down 5% last time I checked, and that is because their profits are down 18%. Now, why would a major bank like Bank of America be seeing losses and profits? Well, if you followed any of these episodes, you'll understand that there is a very easy to see banking crisis coming. And it won't just be the mid-size, the regional, and the small banks. It's going to be all of them. And Bank of America is kind of sounding the alarm with an 18% drop in profits, primarily due to the fact that rates are too high for commercial and residential real estate, which is where they make a bulk of their money. Now, the banking sector itself has much bigger problems than commercial real estate, although I will start to say that banks are now passing commercial real estate loan losses onto their income balance, their income sheet. So this is telling you that these big losses, these big waves are coming. You're starting to see buildings in St. Louis and Boston and Los Angeles, San Francisco, New York, major buildings, some of them purchased for $300-400 million 5, 6, 7 years ago, selling for $3 or $4 million. Now you'll see this stuff on Twitter, but it's not necessarily accurate. They're paying $3 to $5 million for the building, but they're also assuming the debt. So it's not like you can buy a $300 million apartment or office complex for $3 million. You're paying that to assume the debt. So the debt still continues. And we actually hope that the people acquiring the debt can afford it so that the economy can stabilize, which I don't see happening, but I'm trying to be as optimistic and positive as I can for you. We're also starting to see things like yesterday, a $660 million commercial real estate loan in Los Angeles for office space was moved into a watch list. You'll see this happen all the time as the debt goes 30, 60, 90 days delinquent. They start getting moved onto these watch lists. Now, the central banks, which is something I'm going to talk about at the end here, because I wanted to do this yesterday, but this is our new launch in the studio, and the mic didn't work yesterday, so we had to get it working, and here we are today. Jamie Dimon, who runs, you know, JP Morgan Chase, he just sold $33 million worth of stock. Now, I don't want to make assumptions because it's near tax day. Maybe he's paying his taxes. Jeff Bezos just sold billions of Amazon stock. Maybe they have taxes. They don't really pay them, so I doubt that. But a lot of that money is going into Bitcoin. You can see that, whether it's on the books or off the books. But Jamie Dimon just sold $33 million of stock at the same time, almost the exact same time, as the Central Bank of Turkey declared a $25 billion loss. Now, central banks have two roles in an economy. Their first role in an economy is to manage monetary policy. So in theory, in a perfect world, the people would vote through their elected politicians to create monetary policy for their nation. And then they would hand it off to a central bank to manage that policy and make sure that that policy is never altered, never changed, and always followed through with. That's role number one. Role number two is to print money. That's it. So a business, which is what a private central bank is, a business in charge of a nation's finances is reporting a $25.25 billion loss. Really think about that. Really think about that. Where is all that money going? Who is that money going to? Follow the money is an important thing that we'll go through in the show for, I don't know, till the show is turned off, because it's important to follow the money because you can see what's actually happening in the world and stop getting spoon-fed false information on your television, which used to be called an idiot box for a reason. Now, this is an important phase to understand that J.P. Morgan, the reason I'm mentioning Jamie Dimon with central banks is because Jamie Dimon essentially is a central banker. J.P. Morgan owns a large majority of the New York Fed. They have massive influence on all monetary policy, and they know more than you do. So if he is selling $33 million worth of J.P. Morgan stock and you're an owner, you should probably look into doing the same thing. Just a bit of advice. Now, as we go through this quantitative tightening or restriction higher rates environment, I fully expect this to really subside in the next couple of months for political reasons. Now, if we truly had a central bank that managed interest rates for the betterment of this country, they would raise rates right now, create pain, and solve the problem in the future. However, there is an election. If you haven't heard, there's an election in 2024 here in America. And in order to keep an incumbent in office, which is generally what a central bank does, especially one that can just lose money hand over fist and everyone gets rich doing it, I expect them to pull back on quantitative tightening or money restriction and start going back into quantitative easing or money printing. So when we see a drop in rates, it'll correlate with quantitative easing or more money printing, and you'll see inflation go absolutely bananas. Now, the stock market itself has plenty of problems. Right now, we're looking at the largest overweight of the top capitalization stocks. So the S&P, the large cap stocks are now so much more overweight. Nvidia, Google, Microsoft, the Magnificent Seven, add about 30 other companies to that. The only time in history they've been this overweight in market valuation was the Great Depression. So we are looking at repeats of this at the same time that our country is now really ramping up our actual GDP to debt ratio, or debt to GDP ratio. Just came out last week. America is now the fifth worst run GDP, debt to GDP ratio in the world. Came out with a list. Japan now owes 255% more than they make. It's the best way to put it. GDP is the sum of gross domestic products sold in your country versus the debt. Japan, 255% debt to GDP. Greece, 168%, along with Singapore, 168%. Singapore, Italy, 144%, United States, 123%, and that's being generous because our GDP is way overinflated by manipulating the energy sector through natural gas and producing massive profits that are cutting off oil and gas producers in this country. They've been, follow the episodes, I don't want to rewind, but that's what we're doing. Our GDP, even our GDP right now is capturing things that normally weren't to bolster it. So 123 in today's government-trusted terms puts us as the fifth worst-run economy in the world. We're behind we're just ahead of Singapore, Italy, Greece, and Japan. And I just told you, Japan, the yen is collapsing. So you will see follow suit. Greece has already gone through this about 10 or 12 years ago. Italy changes governments like people change underwear and regimes. So I expect all of these currencies to see real problems. Now, the benefit we have in the United States is the fact that our currency by itself is a store of value at the moment. However, the BRICS nations, which have gone through an exhaustion over the past year, their entire purpose is to eliminate that power. And we're starting to see it because most oil and gas trades internationally are happening in Chinese yuan. So these are really big things to look at. Coincide that with more economic information. Again, a little information overload today, but there's so much, and I haven't been on this microphone here in a couple of weeks. Car insurance, in the last inflation, the last CPI report, car insurance is noted to be up 22%. Now, while I was at the mall this weekend watching people spend money they don't have on credit cards they don't need for things they might not use, I actually had a chance. I went to a candy store with my daughter, and I heard the people in front of us talking about car insurance. And the lady behind the counter, she was a veteran. Her son is in the Marines currently, and her whole family is veterans. And she was explaining to me that she had to stop paying for her car insurance because she can't afford it. Now, car insurance on its own is a mandated tax. If you don't have car insurance, you get a ticket, you may go to jail. Health insurance, they've tried to push this way with Obamacare. These are taxes. Having insurance has actually been known primarily as a luxury. By the way, insurance claims versus the amount of premiums you pay never works out. It's a big scam too, but one that we have to go through. But this is the highest jump in car insurance prices since the 1970s. You're seeing the 1970s repeat itself left and right in this economy. That's 50 years ago. We're watching the same things happen. We may actually end up seeing in the end the same type of oil prices coming up because we have some real problems in the oil market. But before I go into that, new car loans. Right now, average new car loan is 9%. I got a car a couple of years ago at 3.5%. They're now 9%. Used car, the average used car rate on a loan is 12%. That means that the average American car, new car, $738 per month. That is unsustainable on top of the massive credit card debt, no wage growth, no job openings, and all the jobs reports. These are part-time jobs from the government to illegals. That's what's happening. Whether you want to believe that or not, it's an actual fact. Now, along with this, we're also starting to see fast food rates. Now, for many, many years, for about 30 years, economists have used the price of a Big Mac as a real good gauge of inflationary trends. Right now, fast food prices, which you shouldn't eat anyway. We all do, but you shouldn't. Fast food right now, the average pricing is up 31%. Some of the franchises are even higher. Popeyes is up 86% since 2021. And we're looking at the average family going out for burgers and fries, family of four, costing over $50. You know, the luxury of fast food has the allure of fast food has always been for people who don't have a whole lot of money. However, McDonald's just reported that their slowest growth or their largest decline in population is families that make under $50,000. That was their bread and butter for their entire existence. Now the pricing at McDonald's is too high where people who make too little are deciding to not go out to eat and cook at home, which is based on grocery prices, just as expensive. You save a couple of bucks though. Now, on top of this, we have real problems, guys. We have so many different things happening from the border and foreign nations. No surprise to any of you, we're in a war in Ukraine. There's a Ukraine-Russia. We have Israel and Gaza. Now we have Israel and Iran. What happened over the weekend was fascinating to see, actually. Iran fired a bunch of missiles into Israel, who has such an incredible weapons system that only two landed on land. The rest were destroyed by the Golden Dome. They also have surveillance techniques that can listen to me in this room right now from Tel Aviv if they wanted to. But, you know, guys with hang gliders, you know, got around that and invaded their country. Nonetheless, with the Iran missile launches towards Israel, number one, there was no loss of life. So this was just a show to say we're tough. Look how tough we are, knowing that their missiles would be engaged by the Iron Dome. Now we have this constant back and forth about Israel and Iran. Who's going to retaliate? What are they going to do? It doesn't matter. They're going to do what they're going to do. We can't stop that. We can't control that. But what I can tell you is that the economy, which is why I go through the money, the economy is collapsing and a war is imminent. This is a historical trend that dates back to the French Revolution. When economies fall, you start a foreign war, create a foreign enemy. People's anger and their angst will go to that foreign enemy and not to those who literally impoverish them. Keep an eye on that stuff. Now, as we talk about Iran and Israel, we have to understand that Iran was funded by Obama for billions for a nuclear program. Trump ended it. He put sanctions on Iran. He made sure Iran could not produce or sell oil in U.S. dollars, which I believe is why Biden pulled out of Afghanistan, because a lot of oil was then filtered out of Iran through Afghanistan and sold to China in yuan. This really kicked off the whole not using U.S. dollars for energy trades. It's a really important thing to watch. Both nations are now nuclear ready. Whether our government tells us Iran is or isn't, it's far too easy to buy nuclear armament on the black market. So assume that they're nuclear capable. Israel is absolutely nuclear capable. And we're going to start hearing a word in the press that you haven't ever heard maybe since the Bay of Pigs, which is deterrence. So deterrence, the way our deterrence system is set up inside the government is as soon as our radars detect a nuclear missile in the air, we have about 6 minutes to respond. Now with DEI hires and transgender nuclear people and whatever the heck they're doing out there, this is a real dangerous situation. So there's deterrence, which is the initial firing, which means we fire back. And then there's restoring deterrence. You are going to hear these two phrases ad nauseum in the next few months. I can see it coming. I can't promise it because I'm not the press, but I can hear deterrence and restoring deterrence coming up quite a bit in the future. And this brings to mind, like, well, how prepared are we if something like this happened? Well, here's an example of how prepared we are, because we have a government that's being overrun by a fascist state. You know, the head of our FDA, Food and Drug Administration, comes from Monsanto, who's been poisoning human beings for the last 100 years. That's actually a Nazi company that was brought into America. All of these hires, you can look at any of our surveillance or technology. Those are ex-Google executives. These are people who donate money to Act Blue and other communist fascist organizations. But one story really popped into mind today that kind of describes and puts, I try not to concern people or worry people, but these are the times we live in. This is the truth, and I will tell the truth whether you want to hear it or not. Aaron Wood. This is a story that absolutely blew my mind. So Aaron Wood is I don't know how old she is. She's probably a 40-year-old woman. She's a mother. She was found naked in a car with a teen who she'd been having an affair with for quite some time. These stories are becoming prevalent. We have a major perversion problem in this country, and it goes beyond any of your comprehension. And I won't get into it in this episode. I'll do that in an interview. But Aaron Wood is married to a guy named, is married to a guy named Doug Ward. Doug is a deputy director at the Commander's Action Group and a senior nuclear deterrence advisor to the U.S. State Command. This is a man who is in charge of advising our nation on nuclear deterrence, whose wife is having an affair with a minor. These are real things that are happening. Now, as this is happening, Russia just announced today that they will be sending advanced fighter jets and air defense systems to Iran. They also authorized some military to move there. They've moved nuclear weapons into Belarus. The Iran-Israel conflict, whether it's, you know, right now today, the story is that Israel is, well, we're okay with the missiles. None of them touched anything. Iran feels satisfied that they launched missiles that didn't hit anything. I don't buy it for one second. This is not how war works. Now, wars are generally constructs of, you know, the elite or deep state or whatever word you want to give it. The bad people who run this world, who own almost everything. They're just in it to capture resources and restrict them and raise their prices, make us poor, and they remain rich. These are not new philosophies. This is actual reality. But when we look at Iran and Israel, we now have Russia moving into place, taking Iranian stance, saying that they will fight against Israel. You have the prince, bin Salman of Saudi Arabia, who's already assisted Israel. And now you have major conflicts in this region that are now starting to branch out. Nothing happens overnight, especially in something this large. But I expect this conflict to spread. I expect it to continue. I expect a few other nations to hop into it in the end. And no one has anything to gain. That's the strange part. No one in Europe, no one in Asia, no one in the Middle East has anything to gain from a bunch of missiles being fired and a bunch of people dying. No one has anything to gain, which means that it's being used as a way to blanket the media, to blanket the press, to scare the heck out of you so that you don't pay attention to the economy that's collapsing and the society that's collapsing right in front of your eyes. This is happening every day. So I do expect that to continue. Now, we're being told by the Biden administration that we produce more oil than any other administration in history. We've also been told that they have more jobs than anyone in history. They're the greatest thing since sliced bread. Now, Trump makes, I think, funny comments. Some people think they're arrogant. I think they're hilarious. You know, saying this is the best of all time. Biden's using the same thing, except he has nothing to back it. There's nothing to back it. Our SPR right now has anywhere, Strategic Petroleum Reserve, has anywhere between 14 and 17 days of oil left in it. These are large reserves that we've drained during an oil crisis over the last 3 years in order to keep the price of gasoline low so that you keep voting for people who are enslaving you step by step. That is the basis of American politics and economy right now. They just came out and said they will not refill the SPR, as I called 2 years ago when they started draining it. Then today they came out and said that they are going to drain the SPR again in anticipation of oil prices out of Iran you know, raising the price of oil. We are approaching an era of the weaponization of energy. Before we actually get into a war, they will weaponize commodities. This has happened over and over again. So what we're going to see here, number one, Iran, their oil production and sales and productivity and profitability is up about 155% since Biden got into office because he's no longer enforcing Trump's sanctions that kept them from producing oil and selling it in American dollars. A very important piece of the puzzle here is to understand that those sanctions are not being enforced. In fact, they're being lifted off nations like Venezuela so we can buy their oil. But we're actually not buying it. We're not buying any oil. Our production right now, in my estimate, I am in oil and gas at the moment, we're probably at least, based on the amount of rigs in the market and the difficulty of obtaining a rig, we're probably about 15% below where we were in production when Trump was in office. That's an estimate. I'm not a government authority. I just challenged the government authority. But right now, we are in a really difficult situation. If war escalated today, we do not have enough oil in our strategic petroleum reserve to fight a war, yet alone declare war. In order to declare war, we would actually have to fill the SPR. If we filled the SPR, we would have to buy it at market rates, buying up all the supply and driving the rates through the roof. Long story short, I anticipate the price of oil to be well over $100 within the next 60 days, and by the end of the year, probably somewhere between 120 and 125. This is what occurs when you start weaponizing energy that other nations need. This is exactly why Japan got into World War II, because we stopped selling them oil. You will find this to be a very prevalent thing moving forward. Now, these are problems abroad. The problems we have in this country are one that I'm going to dive into tomorrow, which is the border. I've been talking about the border since 2021 on Telegram. I've gotten death threats for what I've said. I said back in 2021 that these are not women and children. These will be military-age men. These will be men from foreign nations that are hostile to America. This is all proven to be true. Estimates around with gotaways and caught and all these other things, we're estimating around 18 to 20 million new people in this country. These are people who are coming in, getting free aid, taking our tax dollars, getting free food, free shelter, free flights. And when they stop getting it, I really want you to think about what happens when they get cut off from the government who's feeding them. Most importantly, this is an invasion. We are here, our nation is allowing them to come in, providing them with assistance. And once they remove the assistance, we'll have bigger problems. Like we're starting to see today, over a thousand migrants went to City Hall in New York to complain that the accommodations they're getting for free are not good enough. This is a mounting issue in this country. Aside from the crime, the bad things happening to children, the murders, all these other things that are happening right now, on top of it, they're entitled. They're entitled. These are criminals. They are illegally in this country. I don't care what your point of view is. I really don't care if you want to call them newcomers or call them whatever you want. They're criminals. And they are running this economy ragged. We are approaching $500 billion spent from government accounts to finance this operation, our own demise. I'm going to go into later this week the actual economic ramifications of a border crisis and an economy. Because the end result is not voters. That's the first result. They want voters, of course. You can't deny the replacement theory. It's a real thing. Most importantly, this is a Maoist construct. This is what communists would do. They would bring in massive amounts of people who don't like you, who don't like this country, who want to change this country to be like the country that they just left. And ultimately, they take your jobs. They cause massive prices and massive drops in wages, massive increases in inflation. They don't know any better, so they won't complain. And more importantly, what happens over a matter of 10 to 20 years is you have traffic, you have all kinds of anxiety, you've got different languages being spoken, and there are so many different ways that you have to find to feed your family that ultimately innovation dissipates. You can look at China as a great example. The same thing happened there. They went from, you know, social control by using politically correct language, all the way into allowing newcomers to come in and take jobs, starving people out. They voluntarily gave up their rights, and now that country lacks innovation like no other country in the world, and that's provable by the fact that they opened up cheap manufacturing to steal American IP where the innovation comes from. I'm going to go into that later this week, but I think it's a great topic to go through. Now, there are some really crazy things that are happening in the world before I finish. Before I do that, I will say that this week, 10% of the S&P 500 will be reporting their earnings. This is a great thing. Good or bad, I actually think the market is going to crash. I think it has to crash. Prepare for the crash. That's why I'm doing these things, taking time out away from my family. Prepare for that. Get into, you know, gold, silver, Bitcoin, Copper, great place to be. Raw land, simple commodity. We are going into a commodity super cycle. But 10% of the S&P is going to report. We have existing home sales on Thursday, along with the Philadelphia Federal Reserve Manufacturing Index. These are really important numbers for the overall economy. But right now, we're seeing crazy things happen in this country. We're seeing planes being grounded because engines can't stay on a wing, because doors can't stay open, planes crashing. We're seeing shipping barges crash into bridges. One of them actually collapsed, the Francis Scott Key Bridge in Baltimore. Wait till you see how that's used. That'll be used as, oh, well, prices are up because the bridge is down. Oh, prices are up because the supply chain's messed up. It's everyone else's fault. It's logistics, da, da, da. There were four barges that hit bridges that same week. The only one that dropped a bridge was in Baltimore. But we're also starting to see crazy things happen right now, like an armory for the Army, an ammunition plant for the Army that creates the 50 caliber, you know, rounds that you see on the shelf back there in Scranton, Ohio, caught on fire, damaging a massive supply of military ammunition. These are real things. I'm not a military guy. If you are and you're watching this, thank you for your service. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for your service. But I hope that your service to us as a citizen never comes about. Because we're entering an era right now of real clampdown, before I go into central bankings. Real clampdowns. Right now, we're watching something called the FISA courts, which, if you've been following this stuff and following government corruption, you know that FISA is very important. It stands for Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act. This is something used to surveil foreigners on our territory, on our domestic land, our soil. There is a Section 702 that's going up for vote in the Senate. Not today, not tomorrow, I think on Thursday. On Thursday, this is an authorization bill. And I'm going to read this. I don't generally do that. I generally don't just have bullet points here. This is the biggest expansion of state surveillance since the Patriot Act. Now, if you remember, in 2001, on September 10th, our government came out and said, we're missing $2.3 trillion. And then a bunch of buildings fell. The Pentagon was hit. No one remembered the $2.3 trillion, but what we did get out of 9/11 was the Patriot Act, which sounds great. It's an act for patriots. It's not. It's a surveilling patriots act. It's a complete invasion of unconstitutional privacy invasion. And now they're trying to expand this through FISA. This will basically, the way this works is it allows this, buried in Section 702 of the FISA bill, it basically turns, forces, and mandates small businesses to begin working with our intelligence agencies to surveil Americans. So there are some exemptions. So imagine this. So right now, Google, T-Mobile, a cellular provider, an ISP, right now, our government could get a subpoena and say, I want the records of this target who we think is a foreign agent. Okay, that's the way it works. They have to give up the records of that specific target, and then that target can be surveilled. Not necessarily a bad thing. I do think it's an invasion of privacy, but if it's warranted to watch over someone who's dangerous to this country, fantastic. However, it's not being used in that manner. The Patriot Act hasn't arrested a single terrorist, but many patriots have been arrested. Now, this new act excludes hotels, libraries, and coffee shops. That's really it. So if you're a small business or a housekeeper or plumber or an IT, you know, IT repair person, or you're a gardener, if you own a concrete company in Texas, you are now mandated, you will be mandated if this passes in the FISA Act, you will be mandated to give up all information on any target they deem necessary. This is a complete clampdown, a complete surveillance state overtake. This is something that you need to call your senators and your congressmen about immediately, because it will not be used against jihadists that are in this country from foreign lands, terrorists. This will be used against parents who protest having their kids sexualized in kindergarten. That's been proven. That's a proven fact. If we don't speak up about what's buried in Section 702 of this FISA Act, our housekeeper who comes and cleans our houses, she may be mandated by the government under an NDA to never tell you what's happening, or she goes to jail to take your laptop, to give information about when you go to work. If you get a computer repaired at a computer repair store, you'll end up being the next Hunter Biden. Right, but you don't have to lose the laptop and lose control. They can actually just do it forcibly. So pay attention to that. Get involved with anything happen with Section 702 and the FISA courts. This is very important. And a big topic that's coming up, I think, on April 19th is the Bitcoin halving. I'm going to go through that tomorrow. It is there was a Swiss newspaper who said that the Bitcoin halving means that the price gets cut in half. That's not what it means. It means the rewards from the system are cut in half and it becomes a more scarce item. But we'll go through that in tomorrow's episode and a lot more with gold, because gold just really broke away from the treasuries for the first time in 17 years. This is a really big thing you're seeing right now with a rush towards gold, silver, Bitcoin, raw land, basic commodities. And we're going to go through that tomorrow. But for today, I want to keep things short. Understand that we have massive problems, probably QE coming down the road around September, August, somewhere around there, which is going to cause real big problems in this country. But more importantly, right now, keep your eyes on this FISA Act that's going through the Senate and the Congress. If you haven't found it, it's all over Twitter. There's all kinds of places online you can find information. Please take some action. Do not sit back and let this government surveil you while they're robbing you blind. So let's dive into what the concept is of a central bank. Historically, this is our third central bank as a country. Andrew Jackson got rid of the last one. We didn't have one basically from Andrew Jackson until 1913. Now, in 1912, and I'll put this out to you because there's plenty of people that cover these stories out there in more detail, more depth. But the basic philosophy is that seven businessmen in America decided that through J.P. Morgan that they wanted to have a conference in England, and they wanted to create a new central bank for America that printed money. And they decided that they wanted to take a boat back because it was 1912. On an April 15th, the Titanic sank. Now, before that happened, all seven of these businessmen had tickets home on the same boat. And the four no's got on the Titanic. The four yeses got on the other boat. And one sank. They came back. They went to a place called Jekyll Island. And a few months later, at the end of the year, we ended up having a central bank called the Federal Reserve, which is not a federal organization at all. And it by no means has reserves. In fact, our Federal Reserve is losing money daily, worse than any bank or any corporation that you can find out there. But the real premise in understanding this is because I'm sure a lot of you are hearing, especially from the Bitcoin community, end the Fed. And for those of you who are a little bit older, like myself, for much of my life, I remember, 10 years ago, somebody asked me to talk on, back then it was called e-currencies or something, and Bitcoin. I studied it for about 2 hours, thought it was dumb, didn't think there was any possible way that you could do anything about the US dollar. Well, whether you like it or not, that's happening. There are nations all over the world that are organizing, called the BRICS nations, that are trying to destroy the Federal Reserve and the Federal Reserve note. It is not a US dollar. It is a debt note from the bank. That money that you get, that you put in your pocket, that's theirs. You just get to rent it and buy things with it. But ultimately, you have to pay taxes not only on your income, but on your sales, on your property, on everything else. So after the Federal Reserve was created, they amended the Constitution to allow for federal income tax. So with no Federal Reserve, there would be no need for federal income taxes. Because as I said earlier, your taxes actually don't go towards roads and schools. They just service the debt to the Federal Reserve. Now, here's the real linchpin of understanding the problems with the Federal Reserve or central banks in any nation. Aside from the fact that they are not part of the nation, they are a private corporation. The other problem with it is the mere fact that it creates deception from the inception. We think that we are electing politicians, that we are electing congressmen and senators to do our bidding in Washington, D.C., and that's just simply not the case. As you can tell, if you can't tell by now, pay attention to things. You'll realize very quickly just exactly how horrifically bad we are represented in Congress, because they don't represent us. They actually represent the best interest of the central banks. These were started way back by the Rothschild families. Plenty of information online you can get there. But the basics of these Federal Reserves are that they are money printing machines. They create a value behind a piece of paper. The true backing, everyone keeps saying, crypto and all these things have no backing. Well, what has backing? There's not a single currency on planet Earth yet that's backed by anything. I believe that soon we will see the BRICS nations and hopefully our nation fight back, because there's been absolutely nothing done in Washington, D.C. to stop the BRICS movement. Nothing. That by itself is pretty treasonous. Now, the purpose of gold-backed money is to create real value. They don't have to do that. As a Federal Reserve, as a central bank, they are essentially hiring or selecting politicians who are good salesmen, who have the ability to draw together the people behind concepts and ideas. And I'm sure you've seen this in your lifetime where a politician will come out and say, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. They do none of it. They do the exact opposite and they get filthy rich. It's important to understand this because the more we defend the system we live in, the more concrete it gets in our children's future. And having a central bank has never really worked out well for a nation in a 100-year cycle of fiat currency. So the Federal Reserve essentially uses politicians to sell you on concepts. And here's one of them, Planned Parenthood. Planned Parenthood is primarily funded by federal dollars, by our tax dollars, to kill babies, also called abortion, the kind name of it, and to allow for hedonistic activities in society and no consequences to be paid. It's a different episode. But it's important to note that the central banks themselves, they leverage the politicians to get you to agree with an idea like abortion as healthcare. The real intention behind it, aside from depopulation and many dark purposes, is essentially to be able to siphon printed dollars from the Federal Reserve. They use this stuff because it sounds like a great idea. However, there are no parenthood classes at Planned Parenthood. No one is planning parenthood. They're actually planning the exact opposite of parenthood. Nonetheless, they get billions of dollars that are printed from the Federal Reserve and politicians sell you on it and they put a percentage of it in their pocket. It's not a conspiracy theory, it's just the way the world works. So these central banks by themselves, and as you keep hearing more people say, end the Fed, it sounds scary. It's actually a good thing. And we'll go through that. And that is really the original concept and design around Bitcoin, was to create a Federal Reserve because what it does essentially is it already made money that you have to earn. You can't just print it and get it like with other types of crypto where you just, you know, pre-mine it or print it and hand it out to your buddies, create a market, sell it into the market and liquidate. You actually have to do work on this. We're going to do an episode on this week as the halving approaches in Bitcoin. But it's important to understand that the central bank's role in this country has nothing to do with your sovereignty, your prosperity, or your ability to actually make good decisions, because you really can't. I mean, right now we have an entire generation of Gen Z that if things continue the way they are, they'll never own a home. And that is the enemy's plan. The communist plan is to own everything, you'll own nothing, and be happy. They say this all the time. These are not threats. These are innuendos and predictive programming to allow you to accept the idea. The more you resist it, the more chaos you'll see in the world, because the ones who rule the world want to literally rule the world, and they have a chance now with technology to do so. So as we think back on these things, and we keep talking about some of the things about Bank of Japan, which is a central bank, and we talk about the central bank in Switzerland being broke, the original central bank, in Sweden, also $7.5 billion deficit. What are they doing with the money? What is the purpose of this organization? Central banks, if you're biblical, you understand that the love of money is the root of all evil. Money is not the root of all evil, the love of money. Money also equates to the word power. So when you give ultimate power over money to a central bank, a private corporation, you've essentially sold out your sovereignty of the entire country. And right now, if Americans, once we get past the FISA, you know, Section 702, massive surveillance state problem that we're going to be facing here very soon if we don't vote it out, the next step we need to take is, you know, finding someone better, like the people, like the American people, to manage monetary policy and eliminating money printing. You know, there's a great book out there written by a friend of mine. I'll do that in our episode. It talks about the history of money and corruption. And if you really understand the history of money and corruption, you'll understand that from the inception of time, using rocks and seashells and ultimately gold coins, silver coins, eventually the silver ended up being nothing but lead and the gold ended up being nothing but copper, while the kings and the tyrants actually filled their coffers with riches. This has been going on forever. This is happening right now in this country. We're printing $1 trillion every 100 days. Where does it go? $1 trillion is a lot of money. And if even if we're sending, you know, 50, 60 billion to foreign nations, that still leaves quite a bit of room. Where does this money go? I don't know. That's something we all need to work on as a society and be able to get more transparency. Remember, the government is supposed to work for us. We're not supposed to work for the government. We're not supposed to be answering their questions. They need to start answering ours. Like where all this money from our tax dollars goes to. Every penny, every single penny accounted for. If they want to track all of the Venmo transactions you have for $600 or more, you should be able to ask them where the money that's printed ends up. And I think they will never answer that question. And that's why you're seeing this big movement to end the Fed. They're not saying to end the dollar. The dollar is a currency. We have no money. There are two different levels. There is money, like gold is money. And when you make currency backed by gold, now you have a monetary system that fits all the criteria of money: divisible, portable, potable, all these other things. It fits that criteria. But where we are right now, we're living on fake borrowed debt issued by a private corporation that never loses money. There are plenty of videos out there from central bankers saying that they have the greatest job in the world because all they do is print money and people pay them back. And in that type of scenario, I don't know that we'll ever truly be free. When they have that much power, that much money, they can influence anyone to make any decision and vote on any bill that they like. And I think tax day yesterday is a great chance for us to sit down and really think about who we're writing this check to and for what reason. And where does it go? And do we need them? Just like any other company would assess whether they need a division of the company or whether they need an entire operation, they would let it go if it was unprofitable. And the Federal Reserve, the central bank of the United States, has never been profitable for us. In fact, they've inflated away our money 3,000% since 1971 when we went off the gold standard. And make no mistake, we were slowly going off the gold standard for quite some time, and then we went off temporarily. Temporarily equates to 53 years. That's the temporary measure of going off the gold standard and convincing Saudi Arabia to sell oil and call it petroleum-backed currency. This is a really big problem that I think everyone needs to research and understand, that the people who control our money system essentially control our country in every possible aspect. And more importantly, they control the direction of this country. So many people don't talk about central banking or the Federal Reserve or what it is and how it exists. It is essentially a gigantic monopoly money printer that can actually use another one of their strong arm agencies, which is also not truly part of the government, the IRS, to collect their money that they printed. You know, the memes going around online, on Twitter, everywhere on tax day were awesome, because there are always, you know, a picture of someone standing up and saying something and saying, if you can print it out of thin air, why do I need to pay taxes? That's a legitimate question every American needs to start asking their congressmen, their senators, reporters, anybody that they can. Because the longer we tolerate fiat currency in a central bank model with no commodity backing, no stability behind it, the more we DEI the heck out of our military and make them weaker, the weaker we all become. And most importantly, with the type of money our government's spending and the way that they're raising taxes, our children, you know, I have a 14-year-old and a 10-year-old, by the time they're my age, they'll be paying 80% of their income to tyrants for the privilege of breathing on this land. So just a little bit of history behind that. I think the history of the central bank in this country is very undervalued, obviously, since the government controls the educational system. They don't educate on these things. So I would advise each of you to pick up a copy of The Creature from Jekyll Island, read it on your own, talk to your kids about it, really learn how these things work, because it will help you make better decisions. That if you're paying attention to things in the world, you would avoid the stock market, the bond market altogether. You'd be in gold, silver, raw land, oil and gas, and Bitcoin, and you'd be sitting very comfortably right now instead of worrying about what they're going to do next with rates. They're going to do whatever is best for them. That's what they're going to do. The Federal Reserve has never made a move that was best for the American people. They say they manage inflation. They create inflation. Every time they print a dollar, they dilute your buying power. Inflation is a byproduct of control. It is an invisible tax that steals from every person their hopes, their dreams, their stability in life. These are things that Americans really, really need to sit down and talk about over a kitchen table, a glass of beer, glass of wine at the bar, wherever you're at. These are conversations that need to be had. We are a very unserious, immature nation that needs to shore up what we do and what we talk about very quickly. Otherwise, we're going to end up in a predicament we never thought was imaginable on this soil. So that's a little quick rundown, very quick, brief summary of the Federal Reserve. It was created behind the shadows. It was sold to us as a way of paving roads and creating schools. And all it's done for 100 plus years, is create monetary policy that fails over and over again and gets bailed out by wars, because our central bank, as you're watching, you're being exposed to what they are, they finance both sides of the war. Every central bank finances both sides of the war, and the collateral they get for the loans that they make are essentially your property and your future. So that's what I have for you here today on the Rice Report. Before I wrap up, I will say that in the midst of all this horrible stuff that's happening in these difficult positions and difficult scenarios we find ourselves in, it's never too late to get close to God, to get close to your family. It is so important at times like this that you understand who you are and who the enemy is so you can make great decisions. Sun Tzu said, if you understand your enemy and understand yourself, you'll never lose a battle. But if you only understand yourself and not your enemy, you shall never win. So I will come here and keep giving you information that I believe is being thrust upon us by the enemy to make sure that you know yourself and you can create a better life for you and your family. And that begins at home, begins with your faith, with the love of your family. So until next time, tomorrow, we'll start filming here every day. But until then, thank you so much for being with me for this long time. This is a lot longer than we normally do. But God bless you all. God bless America. Look out for one another, and everything's going to be just fine. Have a great day, everybody.